Hello, and welcome to the lecture for the TI Precision Lab discussing instrumentation amplifier topologies, specifically 1-amp IAs. In the last lecture, we derived the simplified equation for a 1-amp IA. Remember that this simplified equation relies on the matching of R1 to R3 and R2 to R4. The rest of this lecture will utilize this topology across a few different use cases. We'll first cover a simple unity gain difference amplifier with large input voltages. Next, we'll show how you can alter the resistors in the difference amplifier to achieve high gain or attenuation. And lastly, we'll go over an example which uses the reference pin to level shift an output voltage. An interesting feature of this difference amplifier is its ability to process input voltages V1 and V2, which are greater than the power supplies. Take, for example, this unity gain difference amplifier with power supply voltages of plus minus 10 volts. As you know, the input and output limitations of an amplifier are with respect to the power supply rails. In this example, we have V2 equal to 20 volts and V1 equal to 15 volts. These are both beyond the power supply rails, but the circuit works. Why? To refresh on a previous TIPL op-amp video, let us review input voltage ranges and output voltage swings for op-amps. The common mode input voltage range is also known as the input voltage range and is measured right at the input of the op-amp. This term describes the range of input voltages that can be used for linear operation. The input voltage range is always defined relative to the power supply rails. When you exceed the input voltage range, the op-amp behaves nonlinearly. Output voltage swing is the range of output voltages that allow for linear operation of output signals. Output swing is also defined relative to the power supply rails and will behave nonlinearly if you exceed this range. When an op-amp is said to be rail-to-rail in, this means the input common mode voltage range is up to or beyond the power supply rails. When an op-amp is said to be rail-to-rail out, this means that the output voltage swing is near the power supply rails. The output cannot swing all the way to the rail because of finite impedance of the output transistors. Back to this circuit. This amplifier is rail-to-rail in and out. Let us break this analysis down into two categories, input and output. We need to make sure both the input and the output are within linear range. Let us analyze the input first. This amplifier's input voltage range is to the rails, or negative 10 volts to positive 10 volts. Remember that this input voltage swing is measured at the input of the amplifier. That is at the nodes labeled V1 prime and V2 prime for the circuit. The voltage at V2 prime is due to the resistor divider formed by R3 and R4, which effectively halves V2, since the reference voltage is grounded and R3 is equal to R4. Since V1 prime tracks V2 prime, then V1 prime is also V2 divided by 2. That means V2 can actually be as much as 2 times the supply voltage, or plus minus 20 volts, and still be within linear range. Let's now analyze the output. The output of this amplifier is also rail-to-rail, but because of the limitations of the internal transistors, this swing can only go near the rail. For simplicity though, let's say the output swing is negative 10 volts to positive 10 volts. The output equation for this amplifier is Vout is equal to AD times VD plus REF. The gain of this configuration is 1 volt per volt, and we have grounded the reference pin. The output equation reduces to Vout is equal to VD, so Vout and the differential voltage must be between negative 10 volts and positive 10 volts. We previously calculated that V2 can be as low as negative 20 volts and as high as positive 20 volts and still remain linear at V2 prime. We also previously calculated that the differential voltage can be as low as negative 10 volts and as high as positive 10 volts for linear behavior. If V2 is 20 volts, V1 can be as high as 30 volts and we'd still achieve linear input and output behavior, as shown here. If V2 is negative 20 volts, V1 can be as low as negative 30 volts and we'd still achieve linear input and output behavior, as shown here. The input common mode voltage, VCM, is the average of V1 and V2. For this specific circuit, the VCM is equal to plus minus 25 volts. The output voltage, Vout, for this specific circuit is plus minus 10 volts. We can take these boundary points to generate what's called a VCM versus Vout boundary plot. Boundary plots graphically show a designer the usable range of an IA by analyzing the internal nodes. Since linear behavior depends on the input and output range of the amplifier, the boundary plot represents these ranges by plotting the combination of every headroom limit, including the common mode input voltage and the output voltage. The boundary plot shows the achievable output voltage range for any given input common mode voltage at V1 and V2, or, equivalently, the input common mode voltage range for which a given output voltage can be produced. The y-axis is the input common mode voltage, VCM, and the x-axis is the output voltage, Vout. Let's take the example from before on a plus-minus 10-volt supply with unity gain resistors and rail-to-rail input and output operation with ref set to ground. VCM is the average of V1 and V2, which we calculated to be as high as positive 25 volts and as low as negative 25 volts. Vout is limited by the output swing of the amplifier, which we simplified to be negative 10 volts to positive 10 volts. Since Vout is equal to Vd, then we also know that the input differential voltage swing is also negative 10 volts to positive 10 volts. These values shift, though, with gain and reference voltage. A plot like this is able to display all linear combinations of your circuit based on which amplifier you've chosen, the supplies, the gain, and the reference voltage. Here's how you can read this plot. When VCM is equal to 25 volts, the allowable Vout and Vd is negative 10 volts. When VCM is equal to 20 volts, the allowable range of Vout and Vd is negative 10 volts to 0 volts. When VCM is equal to 0 volts, the allowable range of Vout and Vd is negative 10 volts to positive 10 volts. This plot is available with all of our IA releases through a calculator tool called Analog Engineer's Calculator under INA VCM versus Vout. You can select the IA part number, enter your specifications including supply, gain, and reference voltage, and the calculator will generate the boundary plot to guide you through linear design and operation. Up until this point, we have only seen unity gain configurations. The 1 amp IA, though, can be used to amplify really small signals. This is done by altering the resistor values. As we previously defined, the gain of a difference amplifier is R2 divided by R1. We also discovered that we wanted R2 to match R4 and R1 to match R3. Assume we have an input differential voltage Vd equal to 50 millivolts in the presence of a 2 volt common mode voltage, and we want to amplify this to 5 volts at the output. In order to do this, we need a gain of 100 volts per volt. We need to choose R2 and R1 such that R2 divided by R1 is equal to 100. In this example, we chose R2 and R4 to be equal to 100 kiloohm, and R1 and R3 to be equal to 1 kiloohm. You'll see for a 50 millivolt input, even in the presence of a 2 volt common mode signal, our 1 amp IA extracted and amplified only the differential signal and rejected the common mode signal to yield our desired 5 volt signal at the output. The same way we were able to gain up the circuit by altering the resistor values, we can also attenuate larger voltages. We will see how this is done next. Assume we have an input differential voltage of 3 volts in the presence of a 2 volt common mode voltage that we want to attenuate in half. As we did in the previous example, let us select R2 and R1 such that R2 divided by R1 is equal to 1/2. In this case, let's choose R2 and R4 to be equal to 1 kiloohm and R1 and R3 to be equal to 2 kiloohm. As you can see, the amplifier extracted and attenuated only the differential voltage, rejecting the common mode voltage to yield the desired output of 1.5 volts. Let's now take a look at an example which utilizes the reference pin to level shift the output of the amplifier to a usable level. Most analog-to-digital converters, or ADCs, have a unipolar input, like 0 to 3.3 volts or 0 to 5 volts. However, the circuit preceding this can have bipolar inputs, like negative 5 volts to positive 5 volts. Bringing an ADC input below ground can cause irreversible damage. So how do we connect a bipolar front end with a unipolar converter? Assume we have an input signal of negative 5 volts to positive 5 volts. We would like to process this with a 3.3 volt ADC. So when Vin is equal to negative 5 volts, we want to see 0 volts at the output of the IA. And when the input is equal to positive 5 volts, we want to see positive 3.3 volts at the output of the IA. First, we need to determine the gain, or AD, of the circuit. That is the total change in output voltage divided by the total change in input voltage. So gain equals 3.3 divided by 10, or 1/3. Another way to think of gain is by following this equation. Let's select our resistors such that the gain, or attenuation in this case, is 1/3. In order to calculate the required reference voltage, let's go back to the original output equation for an IA. That is, Vout is equal to AD times VD plus ref. When VD is negative 5, we want Vout to be 0. Plugging these variables into the equation and solving for ref, we get ref is equal to 1.67 volts. Now, if we sweep the input from negative 5 volts to positive 5 volts, we will see 0 to 3.3 on the output. This example combines altering the resistor values to achieve a different gain or attenuation and making use of the reference pin to level shift the output to a usable range for the ADC downstream. The 1-amp IA topology has many configurable features, including gain, attenuation, and level shifting. If you have an application where you are processing low impedance sources and high common mode voltages, this 1-amp IA topology can be exactly what you need. That concludes our fourth video, discussing a few 1-amp IA use cases. Please try the quiz to test your understanding of this video's content.